Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name's Bob Wood. I'm pleased to welcome you here tonight as the new chairman of the board of Agenda Alexandria, and on behalf of the board of directors, of members, our sponsors, and our speakers tonight, welcome to the 2017-18 program. We're very proud of what we've put together for the year. We're happy you're with us tonight, and we're extremely happy to have this very skilled panel with us. We've got Maestro Frank Fannin as a moderator tonight. I can guarantee you we'll get to the point quickly, and the diverse opinions we're going to hear are going to, I think, be very helpful to our mission, you know, discussing the issues without taking sides. It is a kind of a remarkable program. It's bid or no bid with a question mark, and then what's next? We know how the city, or may not know how the city, has made a decision regarding the bid, but it didn't remove the problems. And so tonight they'll talk a little bit about those problems and answer your questions and the way we do it. The cards on the table with your questions coming in. We're happy to present this as the lead program for the year. Our thanks go as well to our TC Williams crew with us tonight. We thank Velma and Ben and the team. My old alma mater, I'm very proud to see the program again with us this year. We are community partners, and I appreciate, Velma, your suggestion that we make that a matter of record. We're going to come over and thank TC Williams students for what they do. Not only presenting the program, not only taking and filming and then allowing us to do a little edit, but as well we have writing. We've had stories presented in the press. We're very proud of that student participation, proud of our high school. Thank you very much. We're thanks as well to our host here at the Heritage. You can't ask a question they don't have an answer to, and you can't ask them to do something they don't do on the spot. So we're very happy to be here. I would tell you, as part of our strategic planning for this year, we're looking at finding two alternate venues for two programs. So we're going to move a little and see how it works inside the program. We've got some suggestions and some ideas. I think two of the programs you'll find will be not here, and we'll give you plenty of notice about it. Speaking of notice, on your table is a program that we thank Terry for. She just did a fantastic job. This program really matches what's on the website. We're moving more and more to the web. Heck, we're 95% to the web as it relates to our members and where they're looking for information. AgendaAlexandria.org, it's the place. You'll find the program, the highlights, information you might need. This program on the backside has an application, and we need you to do outreach for the program. We have a good base of members, a good base of stalwarts here tonight. Thank you so much. But we really have a large number of members who really could reach out and get us more members, because that really allows us to magnify the voice of Agenda Alexandria. So if you can, take a program with you. There's some more on the way out. Give it to a neighbor. Give it to whoever you wish to bring in business, in your community, in your relationships around the community. It says everything you need to know about the program, and it's got pretty pictures. So we're happy to have that listed as our schedule of events. Eight programs for the year. Our first is here tonight. We're thanks as well, Bittersweet. I just already have had, it's already been noted, the best food ever had by one of our regulars. So we're thankful to Bittersweet. We're thankful to what they do to sponsor and support our program. So thank you so much, Bittersweet. Hopefully you find the coffee, and I think those are desserts over there later on this evening. Let me have the board stand up. Could the board members please stand for just a moment and be recognized? These are the board members. We've got six new members on the board. So thankful that they provided their insights and leadership. You know, we had two, I think you sit down now, you've had it soaking it up. We had, during the summer, we had a strategy session and an offsite both. And we looked at the program, and frankly, with input from our prior members of the board, took it to heart and looked at the nature of the program, where we do it, how we do it, and how we want to grow. And so we were happy to have both a strategic planning session and a session in which we kind of got the particulars ironed out. So thanks to the board for a June and a July and even an August session to get the program right for our members. We do have a program that's in that in front of you. That I only wanted to highlight really the next one. It's the Ghost of Urban Renewal, and Michael Lee Pope is going to be the moderator. He's putting together a program that looks really at what's happened in the city and why it was happened and how it happened, and perhaps the implications of what happened. So we're going to have a great program for you next time. That'll be on the 23rd of October. That one will be here. We looked around for alternative sites. I think we're going to stick this one here next time, but we're going to be scouting out some other sites to try a different format, different location, with plenty of notice. By the way, our sponsors are with us, some are here tonight. We don't have a complete list of sponsors that I'd like to recognize from the podium tonight, but we will have it in the booklet, which we'll publish. It'll be in your hands. It'll be on the tables. You'll have it next time you come to the program, which lays out a lot of information about the program, some information about the leadership and the city, and certainly highlights our sponsors. And we're very happy to report that we're doing well in sponsorship. We need, obviously, always more. It helps the program sustain, and it keeps our eye on the future as we look forward to, you know what, our 20th anniversary. This is our 20th anniversary. Give yourself a hand. This is 20 years of, growth, of exposure, of expansion, but frankly, focus. Focus on Alexandria, our city, and focus on the agenda of issues. So we're thinking very, very seriously about a 20th anniversary activity. I'll call it that now. I won't get into words like gala and extravaganza. And I'm just saying we're going to, in one way or another, based probably on your input, and we'll come out and ask you, how can we recognize 20 years of service that we have with the city? And that'll be upcoming, and we'll give you more details as it comes along. So with that said, thank you all for being here. I'd like to introduce Frank Fannin, who will be our moderator tonight. I'm going to grab food. You're going to sit and listen, and questions at the end. Thank you very much for being here tonight. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Wood, and thank you for your leadership this year of the organization. I think we have a great program ahead for the next few months, and thanks to the board. It's going to be a wonderful year. My name is Frank Fan. I'm co-chairing this program tonight with Scott Esham, who you'll hear from in a few moments. But as many of you know, this program was originally planned to be about the bid that had been debated for about the last year or so in Alexandria. A few weeks ago, the city manager had met with the city council, and they came out with the decision after much debate in the spring that they were going to put the bid, which is the business improvement district, aside. But we had already started planning the program, so we've shifted a little bit tonight to have three prominent business owners here in the city. They're going to talk about their businesses, what they see Alexandria is doing well, what Alexandria can do to improve on, and then we're going to sit down and have a roundtable discussion, and we'd love to have some questions from the crowd. So as you go through the program here and you have some thoughts and questions, please write them down, and we'll be glad to ask them to our panel here tonight. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to call forward our first panelist. Dan Hazelwoods has had his business for 24 years here in Alexandria. He was picked by the city council to discuss in their forum his position on the bid. And Dan's been a great business leader. And at this point in time, I'm going to call Dan forward. He's going to give about a 3 to 5 minute introduction. And then we'll hear from the other two. And then all three of us will sit down for a longer discussion. Thank you, Dan.
Thank you, Frank. So my business in the real world, I'm a Republican political consultant. So that means that you probably hate half to 90% of my clients. So I worked on political campaigns around the country, moved around. I was living in the city of Alexandria. I'd been working in Washington, D.C. And I thought, hey, I need to do something different. I should start my own ad agency. Went around to a bunch of friends, and they said, come on in, the water's fine. I mean, go start your own business. They lied. Being a business owner, one of the things if you ask a lot of business owners, would you do it again if you knew all the problems you'd encounter? They will think long and hard, because there's a lot of challenges to being a business owner. So Frank had said, I own my own business in Old Town. I own an office, a townhouse building as well. The Business Improvement District came along. I had a bunch of questions. I was kind of confused about what it was about. I started to meet with some of the advocates, and it sounded like a horrible plan to me. And so I sort of self-appointed myself to go out there and campaign against the bid. I FOIA'd Freedom of Information Act requests, City Hall documents, internal city documents. And I'm pretty chuffed to say that I fought City Hall and won. I say that with my colleagues who also fought the bid. The bid plan was based on a couple different things. And one was that it was only going to be restricted to Old Town. that it said that Old Town is aging and that it's got challenges. One of the other questions is, was the city was potentially changing its services to Old Town, and that it was somehow going to help businesses compete. And when you look at how the bid was structured, in my view, it was a disaster. It was not going to achieve any of those goals. It had a lot of planning problems. And I'm highly critical of how the city approached this, but in the city's defense, they had many of the same problems that all institutions do, is that they just decided they could make this happen, and the hard work of it, of the details of how it would operate, how it would affect businesses, how it would help them, were never really considered. So, but I want to take this, talk about the bid, I want to talk a little bit of the larger thing. If you're a business owner, you always hear business owners talk about regulations, and it is an oppressive thing for business owners. And I want to share with you two sort of simple stories. The other reason why I'm kind of chuffed is I beat the IRS this month, so I both beat City Hall and I beat the IRS, so I'm pretty happy right now. But the fight with the IRS was really simple. Now, at the end of the day, this was not a legal fight, this was a paperwork fight. My forms versus their forms. And it had gone on for 5 years. And so if you've ever been a business owner, you get forms from government agencies all the time. And in the city of Alexandria, you get them from the federal government, you get them from the state government, you get them from the city government, you now get them from Renew Alexandria, this new entity that has evolved in our water bills. You're constantly getting bills and forms telling you stuff. So the IRS said I should pay them about 150 grand, and I said, no, you should pay me 70. And this fight went on for 5 years, as I said, and you get these certified letters that say, if you don't talk to us, we're gonna do nasty things and burn down your house. And then so you send back a letter, you call them on the phone, you have that wonderful wait service, and it goes on and on and on. So about a year ago, I finally got to the right person on the phone, and we had a big, long conversation, a very helpful government employee, I must point out. I gave all the information, and then, because this involved three different sets of documents, what the IRS does to you is they send you a letter that says, we're working on it. So imagine, because there were three, instead of getting one every 6 weeks, I got a different one every two. So every 2 weeks, I'm opening up an IRS letter, and I don't know whether they're going to say they're going to burn my house down. And what I learned was, every 2 weeks, is we're still working on it, we're still working on it, we're still working on it, we're still. And this went on all year. And then in August, I got a letter that said, what was that about again? We lost the paperwork. And I'm like, and by the way, we're going to burn your house down now. And if you don't, so I started the process. I literally went on vacation. I didn't get around to it. I was getting close to the deadline. And then I got another letter, and I'm like, oh. And I thought to myself, oh. And then they said, oh, we found the paperwork, and you're right. And in the course of the last week, I got one letter that said, you're right. I got another letter that said, if you give us $2,000, we'll be happy, instead of the 100. And by the way, the next letter says, we're going to give you 70 grand. So, but this is a pit in the stomach, and that's the IRS, right? They can burn our house down, right? So, flip that to City Hall. I live a block from City Hall. I know many of the employees. We have a parking problem in Old Town. They park near my house. I can see them. I know who they are. We can talk about parking issues if you want. I love talking about that. It's another thing the city's not doing well. But I actually go in, and so there's recycling plans. If you own your own building in the city of Alexandria, you must file, as a business, you must file a recycling plan. So this whole building has a recycling plan, and it must submit a fairly complicated plan for each room in it, blah, blah, blah. But I, as a small business owner with 12 employees in a townhouse that has 6 rooms, being generous, I have to file a recycling plan, and I have to update it every year. And this is just one of the maddening things. So this is in addition to my city property tax for the computers in my office. I buy a desk, I have to pay taxes on it. I run a business, I have to pay a business license. I've got like 6 forms to deal with, and I'm not a restaurant, and I'm not a retail. I foolishly did sales tax for about a decade, and I decided to get out of that business, because it's another form. And that form, you have to turn in every week. And I realized I was spending a huge amount of time with this paperwork. But back to the recycling. So I finally fill this form out, and then a couple years later, I get a call that says, you have to fill it out again. I'm like, oh, did I fill it out like a week ago? And they're like, no, that was 2 years ago. It just only seemed like a week. And I'm talking to the employee, and the employee says, you know, I have a button that says, if your plan is identical to last year, just say yes. I said, my plan is identical to last year. Can you push the button for me? Yes, click. That was wonderful that I'm playing. And the employee said, you know, you can actually save money because we're charging you for collection, for the recycling, through your wastewater treatment bill as your business. You know, if you call this number, you can get that taken off your wastewater treatment bill. I'm like, really? That's great. Give me that number. He said, yeah, the problem is when you call the guy, he won't answer. So leave all the information you need on his messaging machine, and he'll take care of it, and he'll call you back. So a couple weeks go by, never hear back from the guy. I call back to the city employee, says, oh, don't worry about that. I talked to Joe or whoever, Sally, whoever the employee was. It's taken care of. That's off your bill. So the city hall can work, but it works because I live a block from there, and I'm willing to spend the time to go save the $12 a month on my bill. That is just two sort of extreme natures of what a business owner encounters every day. And that's all before they can do whatever their passion is that caused them to start a business or try and earn a living. So when the city comes along and says, we've got a bid tax, we're going to do these new fancy things, I want to know what they're going to do for the $1,000 they're going to take out of my townhouse every year. And when I walked up and down King Street, the antique owners, you know, there's a lot of charming old shops in Old Town. Most of those charming old shops only survive because those buildings were purchased over 30 years ago, which means the people own the building outright, and their cost is not rent, it's taxes. So taxes go up, they lose their economic margins. But the city doesn't view it that way. The city compares them to a business that's renting that is paying. So you get all these challenges hitting businesses, and, you know, they're worse for retailers. You're going to hear from other people who have real products. I just sell hot air, which is great business to be in, but as you can tell, I'm pretty good at it. So there's a lot that goes in there. So when people come say, oh, business, it's like there's a life to make sure that stuff works. So I'm kind of proud to have fought and defeated the bid. I'm happy to answer questions as we go forward.
Well, thank you, Dan. And now we're going to call forward Kim Putins. Kim is the owner of Bloomers, which is on King Street, and she also co-founded Bellacara. She's been involved with the Old Town Boutique District for years, and she has a couple businesses here in the city. So, Kim, come on forward, introduce yourself, tell us a few thoughts, and then we'll go from there.
Glad I got up here without falling over. That was my biggest concern as I was thinking about how I was going to navigate those stairs.
Those are awesome heels.
Thank you. When I fall, you'll know why.
Where did you buy those?
I don't know where I got these, actually. As Frank said, I am the owner of Bloomers. But just by way of a little more background on me, I'm actually born and raised in the Washington area. I grew up actually in Maryland, and I made the trek over the bridge to Virginia, which is never done. But I grew up in PG County in Maryland, and about 25 years ago I came to Alexandria. And in that 25 years ago time frame, I also went back to school and got my MBA. And I thought, oh, wouldn't it be great to have my own business? Because that's what everybody in my MBA class is aiming for, is to own your own business. And so I co-founded Bellacara with one of my former neighbors, who also had a passion for starting her own business. At the time, she was a attorney on the Senate Banking Committee, and we were both younger, and we hadn't had children yet, and we said, okay, let's start a business together. And somehow we came up with this idea of starting a retail business. And at the time, I thought it was a good idea, but 18 years later, I'm still doing it, so it still must be a pretty decent idea. But I started Bellacara, and that was, I remember distinctly signing that lease in December of 1999, and thinking to myself, wow, what have I just done? Because prior to that, my career had been in policy, public policy, and then I also had done I started working in management consulting. I was working for PricewaterhouseCoopers before I decided to quit and put everything into retail. But I thought to myself that December, that Christmas time, oh my gosh, what have I done here? But we successfully opened Bellacara, and if anybody remembers, in the year 2000, it was a little bit of a depression, a recession. It wasn't the best time to open a business, but I always say that one of my successes is that I've opened two businesses at the time of a recession, and I've managed to grow them and stay in business. I've managed to defeat the odds. So I owned Bella Car for about 11 years. I sold my shares to my business partner. But in October 2008, before I sold the business, I moved Bella Car across the street. And I had always had this concept in my mind of Bloomers. And I opened Bloomers in November of 2008. And I think you guys will remember what happened in October 2008. Again, another recession. And I thought, okay, I've been through this before. I can do this again. So I opened Bloomers, and I'm thankful to say that we're going to be 9 years this coming November. But as Dan said, you know, one of the hardest things is being a business owner. And I have also had the fortune of seeing what it's like to be in other areas. All these years of being in Old Town, while a business has always been great, and I've loved serving the community, and I'm a member of the community, I actually live in the Fort Hunt area of Alexandria, and I have to say, my daughter goes to Westco, so, and anybody interested, tomorrow night, West Potomac is playing TC in field hockey, girls field hockey, so if anybody wants to come out, because I have a feeling it's going to be a very good game playing at Westco. But anyways, I have to put that plug in. But I have been in the Alexandria community for so long, and I've gotten familiar with it, and I thought, well, maybe I'm too familiar with it. Maybe I need to branch out. So I opened a Bloomers in Shirlington, and then I also did a short stint in Georgetown. Shirlington is a RIT situation, so it's not a bid per se, but it's like a bid, because you are paying CAM, you're paying marketing, which are kind of the same things you pay in a bid, but it's done in a different way. The bid is done through a tax, but in a real estate RIT situation, it's done as part of your rent. So I experienced that. I also had a short stint of a store in Georgetown, which is a bid, and I had experience what that's like to be in a bid, and you know, there was a lot of comparisons during this bid debate about all these other areas and how we have to compete. And I kept saying, but wait a minute, all these other areas don't compare to Old Town. The only one that comes closest is Georgetown, and Georgetown's not a success story when it comes to retail. I'm born and raised here, and I would go to Georgetown in the 80s, and it's kind of its heyday, if you will. And it was a different environment back then, but now it's not the same. So I got involved in the bid debate for a couple of reasons. Because number one, I had kind of experienced the different situations in different areas, but a couple other things that also happened in Alexandria, which led me to really get involved. And number one was the city had passed an ordinance, or not, well, let me back up. They didn't pass an ordinance. They enforced an ordinance that was already in place that in 2008, the city council, when everything started tanking and businesses were going out of business, or some of them were saying, let me make it through the holidays, and then I'll see what happens. The city looked the other way as far as A-frame signs are concerned. They said, do whatever you got to do, businesses. We understand. We need you to stay in business. We cannot, you know, they didn't want to see any more vacancies up and down King Street or on the side streets for that matter either. And the city council, I remember having conversations with Bill Yule and Rob Kopeka and others on council, and they said, we understand. And then just last fall, so about a year ago, the city decided to enforce the ordinance. And I said, whoa, wait a minute, what happened here? Why all of a sudden now? And I found out that there was a committee that was studying it and all this kind of stuff. And I said, well, what about reaching out to the business community? Was that ever done? Did you ever reach out to us? Because I know I'm pretty on top of things and I don't remember ever seeing anything. So long story short, they didn't. And it was kind of decided in a vacuum. So that incensed me a little bit, to be honest. And it incensed a lot of business owners, because I walked up and down King Street, and retailers, large and small, restaurants, large and small, were perplexed. And I've traveled all over the world, and I was just in Greece this summer, and everywhere you go, whether it be in the U.S. or overseas, everybody uses A-frame signs as a way to pull people in, to draw people in. So that was number one. Number two was the discussion by the city council to raise property tax rates. And in addition to that, that was also on the back of raising the property tax rate, the assessment, the assessed values of properties. I saw my property, and remind you, I have been in the space that I'm in for almost 18 years. I saw the largest hike in my property tax value ever in those 18 years, plus an increase in the rate. So I said, whoa, wait a minute, brakes. So that's when I started getting involved, because I thought to myself, so many businesses, I've known so many business owners in Old Town, and they were on the brink. And a lot of business owners, what a lot of people don't realize is that a lot of us moonlight. I have, for the last 10 years, been in management consulting. A lot of people moonlight as well and have other careers, because we don't pay ourselves enough to benefit from our businesses, particularly if you're in retail. So that was what got me involved, because I thought there is no way businesses can afford more taxes at this point, and that's not helping us, that's putting us over the edge. So anyway, so that's long story short, that is my background, that's how I got involved in this, and kind of my perspective and kind of where I'm coming from all the different experiences that I've had as a business owner and outside of that. So I look forward to the discussion.
We have Scott Escher, my co-chair, who's going to introduce our third panelist tonight.
Good evening. My name is Scott Escher. I'm happy to be here and co-host the event with Frank. The third panelist we have is going to offer a pretty interesting perspective. He's not only been a business owner in Alexandria on King Street, he also now is the founder and president of a very fast-growing company that focuses on e-commerce. So he's going to be able to talk about a couple different things. I'm happy to introduce Ethan McAfee. He's the president and founder of Amify, which is an e-commerce partner of Amazon. He's also the previous owner of the Refresh Core Yoga on King Street, and also an Old Town resident. So I'm happy to introduce you.
Great, thanks everyone. It's nice to be here. As I mentioned, my name is Ethan McAfee. I've been living in Washington, D.C. now for about the last 16 years or so. And for most of my life, I was in the investment business following internet stocks. And 6 years ago, I had this crazy idea of instead of investing in internet companies, why don't I start my own? And so that led me to start what's now called Amify. And what Amify is, we basically help brands sell their products more effectively on the Amazon platform. And it's been a great ride. As I've mentioned, being an entrepreneur definitely has its ups and downs. But the internet's fundamentally changing the way that e-commerce and retail works. And I think I was probably mostly invited here to talk about how the internet's changing the way retail works. And obviously, if you drive up and down King Street, you see a lot of empty vacancies and storefronts. And as a town, as a city of Alexandria, what can we do to combat that and also take advantage of it? The world's changing, and the city can either complain about the way the world's changing or kind of embrace it. And hopefully, I can shed some light on how the world is changing. But as I mentioned, I started Amify about 6 years ago. We've grown rapidly. We've been on the Inc. 500 list as one of the fastest growing companies in the United States the last 2 years, which is exciting. We have about 30 employees, and we're headquartered over in Old Town in Canal Center. So that's been the good story. The bad story, I'd say, is I've also been the owner of Refresh Yoga Center, which is a yoga studio on King Street, 110 King Street, for the last 4 years. And I've seen the ups and downs of the retail market and the economy and whatnot. And as was mentioned, the city had put the recently changed the enforcement of the A-frame signs, and like that, without really thinking about it, 30% of our new students went away. And those impacts, as a small business, those impacts are humongous. And I think there's a common fallacy that everyone should just go start a company and it's going to be rapidly successful and unbelievably happy and fun, and you're going to make tons and tons of money. In reality, being an entrepreneur and a business owner is much more like a roller coaster with ups and downs. And every day you don't know, especially when you're early on, don't know if you're going to make it. They did a survey. I think that the common misperception is that most businesses make a lot of money. And in reality, it's much more competitive than we think. And they did a survey. They asked thousands of people, what percent profit margins do you think most companies make? And so, in other words, if you go to Walmart and you buy $100 worth of products, how much does Walmart actually make at the end of the day? The average American answered that question saying that the profit margin would be 35%. In other words, they'd make $35 for every $100 that Walmart brought in revenue. The actual answer is like 3%. And so, unfortunately, being a business owner is a lot more ups and downs than it the average people might be. And so that's why do we have a lot more stress and go gray and lose our hair a lot earlier. I wasn't really part of the bid process. I know that was the original talk here, but I'm soon to be on the Alexandria Economic Development Council partnership, and so I can address a whole bunch of questions on that as well. So Well, thanks, guys.
Ladies and gentlemen, if you have questions, write it down on the pad. We'll get to that point.
I've got the first.
Very good. Got a Frank.
So yeah, please continue to write down questions as we go. We have a couple ones that we want to highlight, a couple of the themes that we have. I think for Kim and Ethan specifically, your experience in corporate America before perhaps influenced what you're doing now. And I'm interested to see how that pivot led you to creating businesses based here in Alexandria, and how maybe the experience of Alexandria as a community outside of the economic business implications influence what you're doing now. I think I work in corporate America, a lot of us do. Maybe it lacks oftentimes the local feeling, and I think a lot of the businesses in Alexandria excel in providing that. And I'm wondering if you might be able to touch on that. Kim, I'll start with you if you want.
I don't think that corporate America really influenced me more than the fact that I wanted to experience what it's like to actually be an entrepreneur and have my own business. I think what influenced me more, frankly, was getting my master's, because so much during your master's, what you're doing, at least what GW had us do, is a lot of projects, you know, sort of hand-on experiences, and a lot of times it was going out and helping businesses to figure out ways that they can improve their business, and I kind of like doing that, but also, at the same time, it made me realize where some of the flaws were, and I thought, well, maybe I can do this differently, and I can do this better. And you know, one of the things they always talked about in business school, if you're gonna open your own business, stick to your core competency. I don't know how many times I heard that. And so that was really kind of what influenced me, but probably also what more influenced me too as a woman is because I knew I wanted to have a family, and I wanted to have something that I wanted to keep working, but I wanted to have a sane environment in which to raise my children, and I wanted to be there for them, which I didn't see that happening if I continued to work at PricewaterhouseCoopers. So, for a large company, I didn't see that happening. So,
Why Alexandria?
You know what? So having grown up in the Washington D.C. area, and I literally, it's funny because I grew up in PG County, and I lived all over PG County because my parents were divorced. But I also went to University of Maryland for my undergrad, and I hopped around the Beltway before I ended up in Alexandria. When I ended up in Alexandria, I thought, wow, this is kind of a cool town. And growing up in the Washington area and going to Tyson's and Bethesda and DC all the time, Georgetown, to me, I was fascinated by how a sleepy town, old town, Alexandria was when I first came here 25 years ago. And I loved that about it. I loved how it was a small town. I loved that it was quiet and just away from the hustle and bustle. And I have to say, I still feel that way. Whenever I have to drive out to Tyson's, all I can think is, God, I just want to get back to Alexandria. But I think that's why. And I love the sense of community, you know, in Old Town Alexandria. But I also live in Fort Hunt area. Like I said, my daughter goes to West Point. I have a son at Sandburg. It's also the same way. There's this strong sense of community. Everybody wants to see, be a part of that and the change and making it a better community. And I think that's why I wanted to have a business here. It just seemed to make the most sense.
Yeah, so for me, so I started out my first 11 years in the business world working for investment funds, and so I worked for T. Rowe Price, which was a really big mutual fund company, and then helped start a hedge fund here in Washington, D.C. in 2001, and did that for about 8 years. And, you know, working in corporate America, you really get a sense of how business works, and so you can go get an MBA or a master's, but my whole life was investing in companies and understanding how they fundamentally work, which really kind of gave me this education that allowed me to have the confidence to go start my own company. And you know, it's amazing to me that so many of the other business owners that I meet don't have those fundamental business background, understanding how financials work and whatnot. And but these people are still courageous enough to go start their own companies. And so that gave me the huge background that I don't think I could ever have been successful without. And why Alexandria? To be honest with you, the reason why I chose Alexandria is because it's just such an awesome, amazing, charming town. And I think it's very easy to forget how wonderful our city is. And you know, I jokingly say Amazon recently rated it as the most romantic city in the United States. I think mostly based on how many romance novels we buy, but the methodology may not be perfect, but it's still, I mean, and the reason why it came up there is it's such a great city despite its flaws, and my wife and I think is extraordinarily charming, and I always say it's 80% of the fun of Washington, D.C., and 20% of the hassle, and so that's why we're here. Yeah.
Kim and Ethan, this one would also pertain to you about the A-frame. So when you mention A-frames, one of the questions is, what's an A-frame out there? And then if you could elaborate on that, and then when the city took these A-frame signs away, was there any policy discussion on that, and how is the business community trying to get them back if you think that's needed?
So A-frames are like the sandwich board signs that you see. They're like this. The reason that they are so important, and particularly Old Town, that's the thing that's fundamentally surprising to me. Particularly Old Town, because we pride ourselves on being a town of independent and small businesses, and we don't have marketing budgets like Lululemon or H&M, so we really have to rely on those A-frames. Those A-frames are a great way for us to say, for bloomers, oh, we have cute PJs that just came in, come check them out. It is such a low-cost marketing way for us. As far as the policy discussions are concerned, supposedly they did put together a committee to discuss it, and what really shocked me is that there were a lot of business owners on that committee, and yet they still voted to enforce the ordinance. As I said, that was kind of one of the first things that incensed me to get involved, because one of the things that I have known over all the years of being a business owner here, and I was around when the first bid debate came up in, 2015, and I remember how the business community came together and said, no, we don't want this. And I thought, you know what, the business owners, when it came to the A-frames, felt so blindsided. And I remembered feeling that way on a number of occasions in Alexandria, because they don't communicate with us about what's going on. And so I went up and down King Street, and I started gathering emails and started communicating with people, said, we're going to do something about this. So what, and then I started working on the bid debate. But the bottom line, what I'm trying to do is that I decided probably the best approach would be, I've had so many conversations with Alex Steinbach at zoning, I've had so many conversations with folks in City Hall, there's some sympathy there, but they feel like it's already been studied. So what I've been trying to do is get, and if you guys have any thoughts on this, I'm totally open to it, but I'm trying to get the Chamber and the Visit Alexandria to come together and put together an alternative proposal to suggest to the city to look at this from a different angle. So that's what I'm currently doing now that the bid is off my plate.
Yeah, and for me, so Refresh Yoga Center was a second floor yoga studio above an ice cream shop, and if you actually followed the City of Alexandria policies, the only allowable sign that we could have is a 12-inch by, I believe, 6-inch sign hanging from the door, which, as you can imagine, is not very much. And so we had a folding A-frame sign out front for many years. And then my understanding is the city was concerned about the safety of these signs. And there was a court case, I believe, in Austin, Texas, or somewhere else, where someone tripped over an A-frame sign and ended up suing the city. And that led to the City of Alexandria deciding to ban them for safety reasons. I think the real reason, of course, is they just wanted them off the streets. From a safety reason, I think that we all realize that the bricks on Alexandria are quite erratic and much more of safety reasons. And if the real reason is you don't want stuff blocking the pathways, well then, why do we allow restaurant seating on King Street and such like that? But when they went ahead and started enforcing that, the number of new students that we had coming to the yoga studio fell 30% month over month, which basically makes the business economically unviable. And so we decided not to have an A-frame sign for a while, but if you don't tell the city, we now have a bike that's permanently parked out front with advertisements for our studio, and it happens just to be, tied up to a local street pole, and that's totally legal. So the other thing I have noticed, it's a pretty bike, it's very nice, it's colorful, it matches our colors and all that. But I do notice that more and more shops, admittedly mostly the chain shops, are putting A-frame signs back out, which I think basically they are saying that either they're not enforcing it or the chain stores are willing to face the fines of doing it. So one way or the other, I think is coming to an end, hopefully.
Thanks. Thanks, Ethan. Yeah. Dan, I'm curious, given your work both in your professional career and also with the recent bid and anti-bid process, are there communities or small governments in this region or elsewhere that have applied a bid effectively or have treated business owners effectively? You referenced some of the antique dealers who perhaps only pay taxes and no longer rent. Are there communities that have done that well and understand the foundational economics of the business owners in that region?
I think the answer generally is no.
Okay.
I think we have actually there's a whole lot of things in our society we've got grumpy this last couple of years. And I think one of the things that I find especially troubling is all of our institutions are really bad at rejuvenation right now. We had the dot-com sort of explosion that incinerated a lot of businesses. We have a lot of destruction of businesses, but we really don't have a lot of self-evaluation and rejuvenation of businesses. There are a few notable differences, and I think government generally as an institution is really bad. One of the things that made me irate about the bid is there was talk that the bid would create a new set of events for Old Town, and it would have a new group of people who would run events. And it came up, well, what are you doing with the current city staff that's doing events? Oh, well, we don't think they're doing a very good job, and they can't handle this extra work. So you're going to just layer on a whole new entity, just kludge it on. And that's kind of how everything works in large entities, large corporations. We just keep kludging it on. I mean, capitalism is supposed to sort of force businesses to really self-evaluate what should be done, but we've got a lot of government institutions that frankly aren't in the business of self-evaluating. One of the stories that was told to me by antique dealers, there used to be 59 antique shops in Old Town. When I first walked to Old Town in 1986, I remember there were antique shops everywhere. There were 3 wig shops in one block. There's still 2 wig shops in that block. So the antique dealers got together and they put together a flyer so you could go and visit all the antiques. You could go antiquing so you knew where they all were. And they put this flyer in the visitor center. Well, the visitor center said, well, we have a rule that every business that has a flyer here owes us $100, so you owe us $5,900. Well, that immediately crushed the coalition of antique owners. And I think this is sort of this goes to the bureaucracy of how things are enforced, whether it's the A-frame signs. There's these new neat signs that are coming up that businesses can buy that sort of are wayfinding signs. But it costs a business $250, I think, a year to buy onto the signs, a little 1.5 by 18 inches sort of plaque that comes on there. They look neat. But when you start adding to a business, this is going to be a recurring cost of $250, that's a lot. I don't want to pay $250 every year for my Microsoft Word to get updated for each office computer I have. But that's the price of my doing business. But frankly, I'm changing how I operate my business because of that. So I think government just keeps coming up with all these ideas. They feel they need revenue, and they're not really reevaluating themselves. So when I look at it, if I was the bid on Capitol Hill in 1988 when I lived up on Capitol Hill, yeah, I would want an entity that I could call up and the police would have responded in the middle of the crack wars. That was kind of important. So I'm sure that was a big asset to a lot of businesses up there when that first showed up. But I think there's a real hard time to say what services are we actually getting for what we're paying for? And the city is saying, and there's a rivalry in the city that says too much emphasis is on Old Town. That's actually one of the other fights that created the bid. So let's tax Old Town more so they can solve their own problems. Well, the natural conclusion of the bidding of the city will be, well, we'll cut the money going to Old Town. So Old Town will get taxed more, generate less revenue for the city, and nothing will change there. I mean, this is the problem of how bureaucracies encounter, and we have a real problem that's a whole other thing, I'll shut up, of communication with the government to the city.
So on the panel here, you can see we have some people that were against the bid, and one of the questions was, cool, who was in favor of the bid and where are they? We did put 3 invitations out to people that were advocates for the bid. 2 of them declined, and the 3rd person said, I don't never want to hear that word again. So we did make an attempt to get some people that were advocating for the bid here tonight, but we couldn't find anybody that wanted to continue to talk about it. But there were some good points, and you guys were in the debate, even though you were on the other side of it. This question is, a bid should put feet on the streets. Now that we're not going to have a bid in Old Town, what are your suggestions as business owners, any of you three, that we can do to bring more business into our community?
So first of all, I will say that when I first started out, they were talking about the bid, I was actually very, very open-minded about it, despite my experiences in other areas. And when I asked to participate in the bid exploratory committee, I was told that I could not support it, I could not participate because I was on the fence, and they were only allowing those who support the bid to be involved in the committee. So that made me want to learn more, particularly after I told you about the signs and the taxes. So, but as far as, you know, I have, fundamentally I have a little bit of a disagreement in terms of Old Town and where we are. Again, I moved here 25 years ago, and I remember when you would walk up King Street from the water, and you would stop at Washington Street and turn around, because there was not much going on beyond that. And then, you know, sort of fast forward a little bit, it's been 18 years almost since I've signed that lease for Bella Cara on the corner of Patrick and King, and it was starting to change, and there was more businesses up there, but it hadn't changed completely. So I really remember when Old Town was not a thriving necessarily business community, but then I've seen it thrive. I don't personally think that we're in a state of despair. I, again, having grown up in the Washington area, I talk about a lot of areas where there are bids and that the bid folks had compared us to. I said, whoa, hold on. Those are redevelopment areas. Capitol Hill was a redevelopment area. The whole area near the Verizon Center, whatever it's called now, the Verizon Center, is a redevelopment area. The waterfront that's going on right now is a redevelopment area. These all are areas that need to be redeveloped. I remember the bombed out buildings over on near the Chinatown. So it's very unfair to compare us to those areas, in my view. So I don't see Old Town as a bad thing. I think we have actually a very bright future in front of us. I don't think we need extra feet on the ground. We are a safe community. We are a clean community. We are a cute and wonderful town that has a caring community. And I think that we're just in natural economics of things. Things are changing, but I don't think it's a bad thing.
Let me just add one other thing. I think, as I always joked, I could make a better case for the bid than the bid advocates did. So one of the things that the bid advocates were about was the waterfront. And this is actually sort of where I'm kind of a little bit different. I'm a resident in Old Town, and I have sort of a different view. I mean, one of the things that a lot of business owners have is we don't want more events in Old Town because they can document that there's no reason for them to stay open during these events. You know, when the Scottish Parade comes down, there's a whole lot of businesses and a whole lot of high-end restaurants that say we should just close our doors that day because their clientele can't get there. So they don't want more events. And my view is sort of the parking problems and events, that's sort of what's why I'm in Old Town and sort of the joy of it. And so the argument for the waterfront is there's a view that the waterfront defined very broadly in Old Town, which means all the way from Canal Center Plaza down, I forget the park that's right next to you there, not quite to Jones Point, but all the way down to Ford's Lane. We have a number of places, some of which have been pretty dilapidated. There was the whole fight about the Commonwealth Boat Club that has a great piece of property, but the building didn't look terrific, and the other parking lot. And the advocates said we should have a world-class waterfront. I actually, you know, another life was a sea kayak instructor, and often talked to that business, why don't you go operate out of Old Town? And the answer was it's a pain to do so. It'd be fun to have, you know, you go up to Dangerfield Island, you can see them doing the windsurfing lessons up there. There's the, T.C. Williams has their crew clubhouse. There's a lot of neat things that could be done on the waterfront and a lot more that could be done there. So the idea of the bid grew out of, boy, we need somebody to get their act together and really make the waterfront something even cooler than it is today. At the same time, that group was also linked to the city, sharp elbows against the Old Dominion Boat Club, because they wanted that space. But as a father with an 8, 7, and 2-year-old, I'm like, hey, the talk of being able to have in the winter to have a little 30-foot square ice skating rink at the foot of Old Town. That'd be kind of cool. Okay, now, never mind the costs and all the problems of managing, because that's a big part. So the bid advocates were like, we need somebody to do that. And the council is incapable of doing that for whatever reason. And so it started with that idea, and then it was like, well, in order to fund all that cool stuff, they had to come up with a tax district that generated the $2.2 million. And that's where the idea grew into some strange creature that was a disaster and couldn't execute its mission, because it had to tax people that weren't going to get a benefit for the waterfront to fund the waterfront, and it was a fundamental disconnect. But that was their vision. And it wasn't actually a bad vision. They just couldn't make it make sense to the people who they were asking to pay for it. So I think just give them their due a little bit on that.
Ethan, I'm curious if you could talk about the relationships that AmFi has with retailers, how branding and marketing has developed online, and how that's been effective, and if there's lessons that businesses in Alexandria can learn from that.
Yeah, sure. So, you know, obviously Amazon and the internet are changing the way people buy products, and it's doing two things. One, it's obviously people are shifting the percentage of products that they buy from the store to online, which hurts retail businesses, but it's also lowering the prices, right? And so it used to be that you would go into Best Buy or your local retailer and you didn't know a competitive price, but now you can search online, and so that means the margins are going down. And so what's happening is that people are going online to buy a lot of stuff because they can find it, and it's easy and it's cheap. And so what that means is, you know, if you look at Alexandria, in Old Town in particular, that the good and the bad is that historically Old Town has had a whole bunch of really small, cute shops that everyday people can afford to rent and start up their own business. And unfortunately, those are the same ones that are being impacted most by this change. And so if you're a small person without anything differentiated, and it's really, really hard. You know, we have to change with the times. And so what you're seeing is a lot more experiential places opening up on King Street, and they're fun to do, and might not be a lot more fitness boutiques and stuff like that. And so it's just changing. But I think, you know, when we walk down the street on King Street, we see a whole bunch of retailers with closed doors, and there's a difference between how the retail business is doing and how businesses are doing in King Street or in Old Town. I think that the average business in Old Town is actually doing quite well and growing, and just the retail streets look a little empty at times. From a branding and marketing perspective, it's the world's changing. You know?
Can I add?
Please, I was actually going to ask you.
Okay. So I remember when the bids debate came up in the city council, and a lot were talking about how, well, because of internet shopping, retailers can't survive anymore. And I thought, really, have you talked to any of us? Because I don't think that's necessarily true. And I was telling this to these guys when we were all sitting here, and I said, you know, what fundamentally has affected retail is not entirely because of Amazon. And I'm going to mention this, and then I'm going to tell you to think about like what's kind of changed in Old Town, and I think you'll start to understand where I'm coming from. But in 2008, in October 2008, when the stock market crashed, in October, everyone pretty much has their Christmas inventory in, or they've already committed to Christmas inventory. So everybody, including myself, who just started a business, was thinking, oh my gosh, how am I getting people in the door to buy this inventory? So of course we offered discounts. The big retailers did the same thing. 70% off, 75%, 80% off, ridiculous, wild discounts to get people in the door. But the difference is that big retailers never stopped doing that. I was just saying a couple months ago, I went into Ann Taylor and they said, oh yeah, today everything's 50% off. And I said, what? Really? I mean, if I did that, I'd be out of business. And if I continued to do that, that is not sustainable. In fact, there was an article in the Washington Business Journal, that talked about this. It might even actually have been the Financial Times, about the fact, and this was several years ago, that corporate retail, the large retail, was doing this, that they were continually offering discounts and they were training the customer to only shop when there were discounts, and how that's not a sustainable model. You cannot make a profit, I don't care if you're big or small, when you're offering 70-80% off. So that's number one. That never stopped. So that's part of the reason why you are seeing corporate retail, big retail decline. And so when people talk about what's eating up Amazon, what Amazon is eating up, if you really think about it, if you really think about the declines, it's coming from those big retailers. And if you think about the retailers that have left Old Town in the last couple of years, let's think about it. Ann Taylor, and ironically McDonald's, which always shocked me. The hardware store, Restoration Hardware. These were all larger retailers that left Old Town. But what keeps popping up? Smaller retailers keep popping up. So that's been always my argument is that we need to not give the smaller retailers reason to leave by increasing taxes and putting on more burdens. We need to prop them up. We need to support them. We need to continue to support them as a community and as a city government. So I don't really see the direness of the internet. And I think the other thing that's happened with corporate retail is they forgot how to treat the customer. Where small businesses never forgot that. We always treat the customer well. I can recall so many times standing at the counter at Target and the lady didn't even say hi to me when she was ringing me up and I'm spending $200. And I thought, oh my gosh, if I ever did that or any of my employees did that, they would be out of there in a hot second. That's, to me, what has been the failure of the large retail. And I think what you're starting to see is more creative, smaller, mid-sized retail that's starting to boom. And I go back, and again, 18 years, and I still see Bella Cara is still there. I remember when Shoe Hive opened. I remember when Hysteria opened. They're all still in business. All these businesses are still there. So obviously, we're all doing something right, and we're not shutting our doors. So if you really think about it, and the other thing I will also mention is in Virginia, we are a property rights state, so we don't have blight laws. DC has blight laws, which means that you cannot keep a commercial building vacant for a certain period of time without fixing it up, without renting it, and so forth. That's why Georgetown is struggling, because they're enforcing the blight laws and they can't get people to come in there and pay the extraordinary rent. So Virginia doesn't have that. And so a lot of these vacancies are chronic vacancies, like the one across the street from me that has been vacant for, 12 plus years. And there's no reason to compel him to rent to anybody. Absolutely no reason, and that will never change unless Richmond changes it. So.
And just on that quick point, there's a weird thing in tax laws. If you're a big enough real estate holding entity and you have profits in other areas, you can be effectively writing off the vacant property. So there's actually some weird large entities that can exploit that more than a smaller landlord.
Ethan, you're a new member of the AEDP board, which is the Alexandria Economic Development Partnership. So we'd like you to just share some thoughts on what the vision of AEDP is going forward, any commentary you'd like to have on that. Also, two other parts that you can put in your address here. Who is the best proponent for business in the city? Is there one? And also, AEDP has $1.5 million budget that the city funds, and I know it's a hard question, first week on the board, but can you justify $1.5 million for AEDP?
Yeah, so I think I technically joined the board on Thursday, so I'll do my best to answer that. So the Alexandria Economic Development Partnership is funded by the city, but is technically, theoretically independent of the city. And their mission is to help grow the economy and kind of be the business's champion, if you will, especially in how, you know, where does the Alexandria want to be in 10, 20, 30 years, and how are you going to get there? And so it has quite a few, theoretically visionary leaders on how, what we want the city to look like. It is funded by the city, so it does have a small staff, but the board is all volunteers and whatnot. And so they're working on quite a few projects in the interest of business and making it easier for businesses to operate in the city, and so and also a lot of work on development. So I realize this board, or the people of the panelists and myself included, kind of bash the city a lot, but I think a lot of it's these unintended consequences, and so the AEDP is a way to kind of help these unintended consequences get figured out. For example, the city of Alexandria doesn't have a designation for internet retailer in their books, and so technically I had I couldn't get an occupancy license for 6 months because I was not a retailer. The office building that my building or my company is in is not designated for retail, but we don't actually sell anything there, but we sell stuff. And so, anyway, these are the type of things that the city probably never realizes, but so I can't get an occupancy license for 6 months, and so the AADP can help work through those type of things. A lot of it is also about development, and how do we put laws into place to help, you know, technology. If we look at the industries that are growing, you know, technology, healthcare, those type of things, how can we make it easier for those companies and want those companies to be in part of the city? They also work with businesses that try to give them incentives to come and stay and grow in Alexandria. So they recently gave grants to both the Motley Fool as well as Port City Brewery to stay in Alexandria, hire people. Those employees that are in Alexandria obviously will pay payroll taxes, and we want to keep those high quality jobs in the city. Were there any other questions? Did I miss something there?
The budget, you can address that one.
Yeah, we just have a lot of parties and we go to Cancun a lot mostly. But I think, you know, the argument I think is that by putting into practice good policies that, you know, $1.5 million budget seems like quite a bit of money. But by putting into place good practices, if you got one good company a year to stay in Alexandria or one good company a year to hire, you know, 100 more employees, it pays for itself multiple times over. And so it's led by a whole bunch of business people that know what it takes to run a business and be successful as a business, and those are the type of people that you want to be looking out for businesses. So that's my obviously biased answer. So these guys might not.
Thank you, Dan.
Well,
you
no, no, no. It's not a critique of AADP. It's more of the comments you made about the business categorization and the 6 month delay, and I think that goes to my point earlier about any institution. Governments everywhere are institutions is so hard to change. Before I got into the bid fight, I was involved. I got a parking ticket, and I went three parking tickets, and I went to challenge it, and that goes into the whole 72-hour parking rule, which is a whole other city fun game. But it wasn't even that. In Old Town, about every 6 years, someone steals the parking permit from my car, and I have to get a new one. But again, I live a block from City Hall, so I have no problem with the remedy. I don't know what happens to you on this end of the town. You have that problem, it probably means you have to come down and visit our retail shops. But so I have a fix. But if you want to challenge a parking ticket in the city, you have to have your appeal notarized. You need to go to a notary public. To me, that's an unconstitutional. You want your rights to challenge the government action against you, and you have to get it notarized. I mean, when I did voter registration stuff in the South in the 80s, I knew why those notary laws were still on the books down there and were being peeled out, because they were legacy laws from the 60s. So I don't know why, you know, as a business owners, we all know where we can get a notary for free. But the best part is after you get it notarized, after you go through all the rigmarole of getting your court date, you get a letter from the city or the entity that's managing this. It says, go to the courthouse, and it gives you the time you need to be there in the room. And I walked in and they give you the wrong room. Now, 20 minutes in the wrong place, I finally figured out that these felony cases were not my court thing. I went out and I talked to a sheriff's deputy and said, hey, what's going on here? She said, oh no, you need to be down there, very helpful. And I said, you know, this form sent you the wrong room? And she said, that's not our form. And I'm like, yeah, I know, but I said, how long has this been sending people to the wrong room? And she just hollered out laughing. Longer than I've ever worked here. I mean, literally, it's been the wrong form for 5 years. And whoever, I'm sure somewhere along the way, a city employee said, we need to fix this, and nobody bothered to fix it. And it just stayed that way because it's too hard to change. And the notarization just seems insane. But these are the things that are legacies of institutions. And so having an AADP that can cut through some of the bureaucracy, but we need a city bureaucracy that lets itself be cut through, and we need to have a mindset across everything that really rejuvenates all these problems that we have to deal
with. That's a perfect segue, Dan.
Excellent.
It's a very perfect, two very good questions from the audience. And this is following up on the AADP. The thought process is to have business owners who can have influence and give insight. Dan or Kim or Ethan, Does the city council currently have a business owner at large member? And
oh, wait. Since there's a council member in the room, I'll ask him about the bios of his colleagues. Is there a small business owner on the council? You are?
I think we have the only one. We have the only one right here. So, I mean, in your discussions and in your work for the anti-bid, how would a business background have supported that? And then the second question is kind of going back to the previous administration. How is the business climate in Alexandria under Mayor Yule compared to Mayor Silverbrook?
I think a business background is helpful. And I don't mean just getting a business degree because, I mean, when I got my MBA, I could have touted, oh, I know so much about business, but not until I actually ran a business. Because I knew the fundamentals of what it meant to run a business and get your business up and going, but I didn't understand the blood, sweat, and tears that go into it, the sleepless nights, as you mentioned, the gray hair, because I am now fully gray as a result of going to business for 18 years. And you know, the everyday challenges that you go through, and particularly I think, and I have such a an appreciation now for retailers and restaurants because it just never ends. It's constant. I mean, I always say this: I'm open 363 days out of the year, so I never get to stop. I think it's not just having a business. Having a business background. I think it's actually having been in our shoes and understanding the day-to-day challenges that we go through trying to make payroll when the snow is in. You know, and I brought this up over the summer when the city blocks off three city blocks to parking and because of road work and it's down to one lane that cars can get through. That has an impact on business. I saw my business drop 30% this summer because of that. When the streets don't get plowed and the sidewalks don't get plowed by the city, and yet we as business owners are required that within 24 hours from that last snow that drops to, you know, from 24 hours from there, the clock starts ticking, we must remove the snow from our walks. But the city doesn't have that necessarily, maybe they do, but I mean, they don't necessarily have that requirement. And when the streets don't get cleared and the city portions of the streets don't get cleared, that hurts business. These little things hurt business, and I think that I said this over the summer that I think the city could benefit from a small business advisor. I don't think a bid is necessarily the answer, but I think a small business advisor in the city sitting there saying, if you block off these streets for this period of time, this is the impact it's going to have. That's number one. How is the different business climate under Yule and Silverberg? I don't think that's necessarily different. I think that I did a lot with Ms. Mayor Yule, Rob Kropika, and I think that because back then I took up the debate on when they were installing the parking meters and had raised the rates, and I explained to them how when you don't change out the meters to the credit cards but you raise the rates, everybody's running in store going, I only have two quarters and I've got 15 minutes because they raised the rates. That hurts business. And so I found a lot of reasonableness from them, and they immediately changed, lowered the rates back until the meters were installed. So I found a lot of reasonableness. I think Mayor Silverberg is open to what the businesses are saying, so I don't really see any difference. I think the only difference I see is with the rest of the council, no offense, Councilman Chapman, but I see it from the rest of council, and I don't understand why. Particularly when we've made so many compelling arguments over the last couple of months, and it's really coming from our heart and soul, and our only agenda is to continue to be a thriving business here. So I just don't understand why I can't break through, and that's my only difference I can say.
I would differ just a little bit because I think it's most of the challenges for business. First of all, whatever comes afterwards, this is how business is reacting in the city is false because there are so many different variations. There are large businesses, there's retail, there's office, there's restaurants, there's fast restaurants, there's high-end restaurants, there's restaurants in Old Town, there's just so many different pieces of it. I mean, I took my 8-year-old daughter a couple times when I went door to door on talking to business leaders, and the amount of diversity just in Old Town itself amongst businesses is huge, of what they do, how they view the world. Most businesses would prefer the government not to bother them. They're like, give me the form, fill out the form, and be done with it. And what drives, I think, business leaders crazy, or business owners crazy, is that the forms keep coming and coming, and there's always something new. And heaven forbid you've got to have somebody come and inspect something. And, you know, and there's lots of issues. And so I think there's, it's real easy for the large institution of a government, and again, it's every government. And I would actually say, you know, I can point to a number, as I did earlier in my remarks, there's city employees who do really good stuff to help businesses, and I think, you know, that's part of what you're trying to do. But I think as an institution, it just is sort of there. And if you don't wheedle and work the bureaucracy, and I have, like I said, I have the pleasure, I can spend time, I can walk my dog to my business, I can stop in City Hall, and I can spend 15 minutes to get my thing fixed. If I lived on this side of town, I would be done with it, because it would just be too much of a pain to go down there and get it fixed. So I think it's just a cultural mindset that the government institution has to be, how can we make your problem go away and resolve and be done? We want to get out of your way. But that's not really, you know, how it operates.
Yeah, I would say I haven't really seen much difference between the two mayors. You know, my general sense is that Old Town, or Alexandria in general, is an amazingly beautiful place with a great culture. We need to make sure that we keep that culture alive. But at the same time, we have to embrace change and admit the world's changing. And, you know, so the people who are going to anti-development to, you know, such an extent, I get a little scared of at times. And I don't, especially down by the waterfront in Old Town, there's a whole bunch of old dilapidated warehouses, and I fail to see the argument of why we don't want to redevelop these to something beautiful. And how can we come to a compromise of, you know, maintaining the aesthetic and the look and the feel and having more parking and all these things, but also making our place a better, you know, city to live in, not today, but in 30 years. If we do nothing in 30 years, it's all going to be bad. So.
Okay. We're nearing the end of our discussion now, and I'll just go through the panel here for some final comments and thoughts, but a couple things that are happening here in Alexandria in the last few years. The casinos open across the river. Have any of you sensed or seen any impact from the casino into Alexandria? That was a program that we had last year. The Alexandria waterfront is being redeveloped, and the National Science Foundation is going to be bringing a whole bunch of employees in here in the next few months. So as we just go down the line here, feel free to add any final comments. You can comment on that, and just we'd like to see your thoughts or vision for the future of Alexandria and business maybe over the next 10 to 20 years. Kim?
Yep. So I remember when there was a big commission study about when the casino and the whole National Harbor was coming across the street, and everybody was worried about what the impact on businesses were going to be, and I laughed because I grew up in PG County, so I said, come on, it's PG County. People are going to still come to Alexandria. And I can honestly say I've not seen any change in my business as a result of National Harbor, and that's why I don't freak out about the waterfront, down the Southwest waterfront either. I think it actually kind of helps us. Because I feel like, I mean, I go over to National Harbor, but I feel like it's a Disneyland, and people want something more authentic, so that's why they come over to Old Town. And there's only so much you can do with National Harbor. As far as the future of Old Town, I think reasonable change is always good. I was definitely one of the people that was very vocal many, many years ago about, you know, we need to have reasonable change in Old Town. You know, it's not a bad thing, you know, but let's, you know, be smart about it. Because they do attract people, and they have marketing dollars, and that helps take some of the pressure off of the small businesses. So I think change is good. I think, though, that when we are changing, that we need to be reasonable and responsible about what that change means. And again, having my perspective of growing up here in the DC area, parking is a really big issue, and I think that's again, it's going to be our next fight. Because I see some of the things that I'm reading, some of the things that I'm hearing the council saying, and sometimes I wonder, do they really think we're going back to horse and buggy times? Or do they really think that I'm going to take my family of four down GW Parkway and put them on bikes and come to Old Town? I mean, come on. I mean, reasonably, I'm going to drive. And so I, you know, if we're going to have all this development, then we need to address the parking issue. And we can't just skate over it. It's an issue, and I really get concerned. Georgetown, if we become like Georgetown, who has a serious parking problem, and I'll tell you right now, I bet my money on it, that is the reason why they are struggling with their retail and their restaurant community. There's no place to park there, and even if, and they're not, and actually if you think about it, there's really not even that many parking garages. And if you do park there, they're so outrageous, by the time you spend the money, you can't even afford to shop or eat. So I don't want to see that happen. I think we have so many examples of poor decisions in this Washington metropolitan area that I think we should learn from that, and I think we should be above that, and I think we should be the smart Alexandrians that we are and look for more creative solutions and better solutions and not fall into the trap of all the other areas. So that's, I think, our future, and I think we have a bright future if we can address the challenges that we've got.
For me, yeah, I would echo most of what Kim just said. Just the new casino opening up I haven't seen any impact. I mean, to be honest with you, after it opened, there hasn't been any talk of it. I am proud to say, of my business colleagues, I am proud to say that I know they are going to be sponsoring the first night, the big fireworks display on New Year's. So that's kind of a nice little benefit that I guess we get from them. I'm totally excited about the development of the waterfront. I know it's going to take 5 years or 10 years or whatnot, but we're going to take a beautiful area and make it so much more beautiful. And I know there's a lot of challenges with it, but that's super, super exciting. And I also echo the thoughts on the parking is the biggest issue for small retailers in Old Town. And I compare it to, look at the success that Bethesda has had by installing large, reasonably priced parking everywhere, and that has allowed that retail to totally thrive. And there just aren't that many people that live in Old Town. There aren't that many parking spots, and so how can we get over that? But I think it's for the best city in the country, and that's why I live here, and I think we should be excited about the future, not scared about changes and things like that.
I'd also say I'm pretty optimistic about where we are, and I think the problems always arise with some version of somebody saying, oh, I want Old Town to be something that either it can't or it isn't. Old Town and Alexandria in general is different from others. We have a very limited metro line access in our city. If you're coming to Old Town in particular, you're on the Beltway if you're coming any distance, or the travel arteries there are limited. We're not competing with Tyson's. Tyson's is a different creature entirely. If you're thinking about, do I go to Pentagon City Mall, which according to some futurists, malls are gonna become new apartment places, because everything in there is supposed to die from Amazon. But we are going to survive because of our uniqueness, and it's how we manage that. Like I said, my case for the waterfront, I think what I said earlier about the waterfront was better than any of the bid advocates said about the waterfront. That we can have some good stuff if we embrace who we actually are and make it work, as opposed to trying to pretend who we're not. But the good news is that the way history tends to work, the business is going to change and force these changes on us, whether we like it or not. And the question is whether our city government is good in communicating with the businesses in these transitions or not. But it's going to happen.
Great. Well, once again, thank all three of you for being here tonight. It was very interesting. I'd like to thank my co-chair, Scott Esham, being up here tonight. I think this is Scott's new board member, and the first meeting he ran the show here. So thank you, Scott, for all you do. And now we'll turn it back over to Bob Wood to close out the meeting.
I thank you on behalf of the audience. There are a lot of questions there. Look at the pile in front of Frank here. By the way, if you could stick around a minute or two, I bet you can get some comments afterwards as well. What a great diversity of views. What a remarkable set of experiences. Awfully happy that you brought it to us tonight. Councilman Chapman, thanks for joining us. He was taking notes, and he wants you to know your last name, Kim.
He knows already.
Well, we heard advocacy.
He runs when he sees me.
Yeah. Well, no, we all should run and ask you questions again. So thank you for being such a great kickoff for the year. We didn't have to ask and talk about the bid. We talked about the business. Thank you so much for your perspectives. Ladies and gentlemen, let me remind you, 23 October is our next program. It's going to be on the growth or the ghost of urban renewal. Very interesting perspectives. We've got four speakers who can bring together what it was meant to do, what it accomplished, and maybe what happened afterwards. So it's an interesting program. We ask you please to tell your friends, take that program with you and hand it off to the nearest neighbor. And I think just from tonight, you should be excited about the direction and the program this year. Once again, thanks to all, and to the panelists, give them one more hand. Thank you very much.